So now we just solved 3 out of 8. 3 out of 8 of them were really easy. Now for the next ones, they're actually going to be tougher, and we're going to need to know a new rule. Because notice, all these other ones have both positive and negative regions. So how do I know if it's a nucleophile or an electrophile? And that actually is one of the biggest questions that I get when we're in the section. Johnny, how do I know that's a nucleophile? How do I know that's an electrophile? And it turns out that there's this rule that we can use to figure out if it's going to react more like a nucleophile or react more like an electrophile. Is that cool? So I'm going to teach you that rule. And what that rule is this. The side of the dipole that has the highest bonding preference can be used to predict the nucleophilicity or electrophilicity. So what that means is that I agree with you. There are two charges on all of these molecules. On the 5 molecules that are left, there's 2 charges. There's a positive and there's a negative. Okay, let's look at A. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to say which of the sides is the one that can make the most bonds. So for example, the positive charge is on a carbon. How many bonds can carbon make? 4. Okay. The negative charge is on a chlorine. How many bonds can chlorine make? 1. Okay, remember, according to bonding preferences. I told you, you're going to keep using bonding preferences all semester. So is this going to react more like a nucleophile or more like an electrophile? And the way that I look is I just basically look at the 4, I look at the highest bonding preference, and I look at that charge. That's the one that I pay attention to, because that's the one that has the highest bonding preference. So the answer is that this is going to be what? This is actually going to be a really good electrophile. Why? Because the atom that has the highest bonding preference is the one that is positively charged. Isn't that cool? And that's the what you're going to use for all of these. So what I want you guys to do is, we already figured out B. What about C? Is C a good nucleophile or electrophile? I actually forgot to say this earlier. I should have pointed this out. Is C a nucleophile or an electrophile? This is actually one of the easy ones too. I forgot. So there was actually 4 easy ones and 4 hard ones. C is easy. Okay, so I'm going to highlight this one as well. The answer is that it is none of them, okay? Because I just told you, it's not even reactive at all. So if it's not reactive at all, how can it be a proton lover or an electron lover? It's a nothing lover. It just loves itself. It's a narcissist, okay? So it's just going to be inert. It's not going to react with anything, so I wouldn't consider it an electrophile or a nucleophile, all right? So what that means is that really this has become a lot easier for you guys. All you need to do is identify F, G, and H, and tell me what you guys think in terms of if they're going to be electrophiles or nucleophiles. What do you guys think? So go ahead and pause the video now and use that rule to determine these last 3.